Okay, we can start. Before we start, there is a if people are finding problems in getting in, we knew that there was going to be a lot of people coming, so there are two more rooms where we are passing this stream live, free stream. So if you see people outside or people who are standing, there's still some rooms, a few spaces here, but in any case, there are two rooms. One is the Euler room and the other one is the Stasi room. The easiest way to find the Stasi is the one just besides the cafeteria, the bar. So anyway, so let's start. So people who are standing, I think that there's still a couple of places here you want to take a seat, please. Okay, so, well, as many of you know, that we are living exciting times in physics and at ICTP. ICTP is turning 50 this year, and when you turn 50, you have to celebrate, and one of the celebrations is to have top scientists coming here and do what they do best, is to teach and contribute to sharing the knowledge, and this week has been an outstanding week in that regard. We have been actually lucky to be 2 weeks and a half after this big discovery from BICEP, so the speakers were also, some of them were able to, I mean, they changed the subject so that we can follow the excitements about the discovery of tensor modes in the cosmic microwave background, which is one of the biggest discoveries in, I think, many years. And but we have, this turning 50 is interesting because in 1964, when ICTP was started, we share the same birthday, the same birth year, with the very prominent structures, so the quarks, the Higgs field, and the discovery of the cosmic microwave background. So it's a perfect present for us for a 50th birthday is to get the tensor modes also here, and to have these top scientists with us this week. And one of them, I think, is a good friend of ICTP, is Nati Seiberg. For all of us in high energy physics, he doesn't need any introduction. He's one of the world leaders in the field. There are people here in the audience who may be in other fields and may need more information from me, but it's a pleasure for me to say, because I don't have to read anything to introduce Nati, because even though I just realized that we were born in the same year, which is kind of frustrating for me, so I always look at him as one of the always about persons above me, and actually, since I was a student, I was always following these papers of Dyna and Cyber, and Dan Affleck and Signer and Cyber, and then with Witten and many other people. And it was obligatory reading for us to follow his work. And we are aging together, I think. And I still see him up all the time. And he has made a wonderful career. He has made many, many, many contributions to theoretical physics. It's hard to put them all together. There are some highlights, of course. And one of them, of course, is his great work on beautiful work in supersymmetric theories, in particular the famous Cyber-Witten theory for n equals to 2 supersymmetries, which created a big revolution in the 1990s, and immediately after that, there was the famous cyber duality that we all have been following, which is outstanding work. He's actually a perfect role model for a young scientist, because I have followed how he works and how he presents his result. The students can see it with these lectures today and yesterday. He has this talent to identify good questions and go all the way and find concrete answers. And sometimes I feel envious, you know, when you see when he's presenting something, you say, oh, why is it that I didn't do it? Why is it that I didn't think about that? And that's a measure of how great a scientist can be, and Nati is a good symbol for that. So it's a pleasure to have Nati here. So let me introduce him, and I hope that you will enjoy this colloquium.
Thank you, Fernando. So Fernando is also a good friend. I'm really embarrassed by the introduction he gave, because there's no way I could live up to the expectations he created. So I hope you will not be disappointed too much. It's really a pleasure to come here to ICTP. I visited this place many times in the past. In fact, I had an embarrassing moment today because I talked to some students here, and I said that I first lectured here in 87, and the response was, well, that's when we were born. And I do find it depressing, though. This is a great place, great celebration of 50 years. This is a wonderful setting, very charming institute as far as the setting. But what I think is more important is the mission of this place, which I think is absolutely important, both for physics and also for world affairs in general, promoting peace, exchanging of ideas, pursuing science. This is all something that we should do. And I think it's good for everybody, not just for scientists. So I encourage to continue that, and I congratulate Fernando for all the achievements you have made here. I'm sure you will continue to bring this place forward. So this brings me to the questions I brought you here to hear about this, where are we heading? And I'll give you the quick answer now so that you don't have to stay for the rest of the talk. I have no idea. So this is kind of false advertisement. I brought you here. I do not know where we are heading. But I would like to give you some perspective of where we are. And that's what I'll do. I'll give a broad brush overview of particle physics, where we are in the field, and how we got here, a little bit of history. I'm now sufficiently old that I can have some historical perspective. And I'll present the problems and challenges. In science, it's always the case that what we understand is not interesting. In schools, you learn what we understand. But the real interest in science is always in the things we don't understand. These are the things that we'll understand tomorrow. So in science, it's always this thing that what we don't understand, the challenges, is what's exciting. And once we figure it out, it's no longer interesting. This is kind of old news. So I'll present the problems and the challenges and try to outline where I think we are heading. Now, what you're not going to hear in this talk, I'm not going to present any experimental information, certainly not new experimental information. There will be no theoretical computation. The people here who have been attending the school, you have heard more than enough of that. You don't want more of it. No new models. I will only talk about things that are well known and no new concepts. But I would like to wrap things in a way that would make it easy to remember, kind of with a few short slogans. So one big hit in the last several years was the discovery of the Higgs particle. And there was discussion at the beginning, is it a Higgs or not? Well, now it's completely official. Even the Nobel Committee decided, they're always very conservative, they've decided to give the Nobel Prize, recent one, to Higgs and Englert. And this is the citation that you can read here for the discovery for the particle that they predicted long ago, more or less 50 years ago. And now it was discovered, this particle was discovered at CERN, at the LHC. I just copied this citation from the Nobel Committee website. So yes, this is a Higgs. The Higgs particle was discovered. But the next question to ask, which has not yet been completely settled, is this indeed the standard model Higgs? The standard model of particle physics predicts one specific Higgs particle with specific properties, and it has not yet been completely established that the particle that was discovered at CERN is indeed the Higgs with underscore the word the. Is it the Higgs of the standard model? Well, so far it seems to work very well. It seems that the standard model with a single weakly coupled Higgs seems to work extremely well, perhaps surprisingly well, maybe I would say even disturbingly well. And the standard model description of nature seems to be at least an approximate description, at least approximately true, if not very accurately true. So for the rest of the talk, I'm going to assume that this is indeed the Higgs. So I'm going to say what else will be measured, how they will measure it, and so forth. And I'm going to assume that all this will work at least approximately right. We're not going to see any major deviations. And I'll show that soon. So first of all, where will we get more data? So in the near future, it's going to be very exciting because a lot more data is going to come. First of all, the LHC will resume operation in 2015. It's now shut down for an upgrade. It will resume operation at roughly twice the current energy. Just for the younger people in the audience, higher energy means like shorter distances. This will give us a way to probe nature at much shorter distances. We'll also have higher luminosity. The rate of collisions will be much higher, and therefore there will be a lot more data, and the statistics will be a lot better. All this will give us a lot more information about shorter distance physics, and we'll get something like a factor of 5 or so, depending on how you look at what process and so forth, in accuracy and in shorter distances. So this is like having a microscope, which is much more powerful than we currently have, and this is going to start working very soon, so it's very exciting. A new horizon will open up. There are also other experiments that I will say very little about here. There are lots of precision experiments being done, measuring various dipole moments of various particles. These are non-accelerator experiments. Very interesting. They could give us new exciting results. There are dark matter searches. Dark matter is very interesting. It might even be related to electroweak breaking. And of course, there is cosmology that Fernando has already alluded to. A few years ago, we had data from Planck. Now there's BICEP 2. And I think it's even more exciting is the ellipses that will either confirm or not confirm BICEP 2 and many other measurements that will give us more insight further down the road. So I'm going to say very little about these experiments. I'm going to focus on the LHC and what lessons it can teach us. So what will the LHC find? Well, that's a good question. And of course, I don't know. Nobody knows. That's why we do experiments in physics, because we don't know what the answer would be. Otherwise, there would be no point in doing them. But we can anticipate. So what are the options for the near future? What can we expect? First, could be nothing else. It will be the standard model Higgs. It will be measured very accurately. And that's all that will be found. It will work. The standard model will work very well. Superficially, this is very exciting. We have a model, and we confirm that it is true. Other possibility is that we'll find something beyond the standard model, something that the standard model does not explain. And this could arise in various ways. It could be that the Higgs production rate will be different than expected in the model. The Higgs also decays in various channels, and we can measure the branching ratio. How often does it decay in one channel relative to another? And that could agree with the standard model or might not agree with the standard model. There are also many other processes that the LHC measures, and in every single one of them, we can find a discrepancy from the standard model prediction. So this will be interesting. And most dramatic, we could find new particles. Not just kind of small deviations in the numbers, but actually new particles, particles that are not present in the standard model. So this is the first fork in the road. Are we going to find anything beyond the standard model or not? So option one, nothing beyond the standard model, and option two would be going beyond the standard model. And if we go beyond the standard model, it could be extended in various ways. And I tried to organize that in a way that would be easy to remember. And the easiest way to remember it is according to the spins of the new particles that will be added. So the first possibility, and every one of these possibilities has been discussed, there are thousands of papers, literally, if not more, I think tens of thousands of papers on every one of these options. There could be additional scalar particles, more particles, not in the standard model, particles that have no spin. And one typical example is two Higgs doublet models. Just as we have one Higgs doublet in the standard model, maybe there are two of them. And many, many people believe that would be the answer, and that has a clear signature at the LHC. This might or might not be discovered. Option two, going up in the spins, there could be particles with spin a half. Additional fermions, for example, massive vector-like particles. Again, tens of thousands of papers exploring that, the consequences, the signatures, the experimental signatures, and so forth. There could also be new particles with spin one. And the characteristic name here is Z prime. There could be a new force, a new particle with spin one, like a new photon, heavier one, that the LHC can produce. As we keep going up, it's getting more interesting. Maybe there's a new spin three half particle. That people who like supersymmetry really like spin three half. The spin three half particles of supersymmetry will not be discovered at the LHC because it's too weakly coupled. But maybe other particles with spin three half could be discovered. And of course, we can go up to higher spins. Now, just finding a new particle is interesting. There's a lot to study. But what we really hope is that there would be not just a new particle or a new discrepancy from the standard model, but something that points to new concepts, some a conceptual extension of the standard model. Just not just repeating the same thing as it was before, but instead finding new concepts of nature. That could very well happen. And again, these concepts fall in various categories. So what can be the more conceptual extensions of the standard model? Option one that many people really like is the idea of supersymmetry. This is an idea that we double the number of particles. For every fermion we know about, there's another boson. And for every boson we know about, there's another fermion. And the hallmark of these is that this is a weakly coupled theory. The interactions are relatively weak, and it's relatively easy to analyze the dynamics, relatively easy to analyze the consequences. Experimentally, so far we haven't seen a sign of it. This might or might not be true, and we could be lucky and it is discovered, or we might not be lucky and it will not be discovered. Let experiment answer this question. Second class of ideas is that dynamics is not weakly coupled, but it is strongly coupled. And this usually comes under the headline of technicolor or warped extra dimensions or various other synonyms to that. The idea is that there is another strongly coupled field theory, a lot like QCD, like the theory of the strong interactions, acting in the TeV range of energies, energies that the LHC can explore. And these things could do also all sorts of interesting things, the way it couples to the Higgs boson, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, the most interesting possibility of them all, here I'm just enumerating all logical possibilities that people have entertained. So weak coupling with supersymmetry, strong coupling with technicolor. And of course, the most exciting one is that something we have not yet thought about, something completely new, something completely fresh. If I had to bet today, this is where I put my money. Nature is often much smarter than the people who study it. And often surprises us with things we haven't thought about. And it's hard to imagine that so many physicists worked for so long and didn't think of something, but we've seen it so many times in the past. This is where I put my money. So I've been talking now for a few minutes. I'd like to give a one-line summary of where we stand, because one line, people my age, it's hard to remember. If the conclusion is one sentence, maybe we can remember it. So the one-line summary, one-line status report, is of course never precise, never accurate, and there are many caveats, so one has to be careful with such simplistic one-line summaries. But this is my take. So the measured Higgs mass, the fact that it was measured at around 125 GeV, this number is extremely interesting. And I chose my words carefully here. It's uncomfortably high for supersymmetry, and uncomfortably low for strong dynamics. So when I talked before about the conceptual changes that can happen, things that can be discovered, we can already say that these two options of supersymmetry or technicolor, without even looking at the details, and of course there are many caveats, and there will be somebody in the audience who will tell me, yes, but there's one paper I wrote 7 years ago which has this or that loophole. Yes, I know, there are many caveats. But the broad brush picture is that this number 125 is too low for technicolor and too high for supersymmetry, and we'll have to understand what this thing means and how to live with it. There'll be more details about this below, but let me start from the beginning, where we are and where we are. So this was kind of a broad summary of where we are heading, and now I'd like to go into more detail. So we have this beautiful standard model. And at this point, I'd like to emphasize that one of the founders of this institute, Abdus Salam, or the founder of this institute, was also one of the founders of the standard model. And he received the Nobel Prize for his work on the weak interactions. But he also made, of course, many other important contributions in physics, primarily particle physics, including the strong interactions, the weak interactions, developments of supersymmetry, and so forth. And this model, the standard model, is extremely successful. It is by far the most successful model in science. There isn't any other branch of science that has anything that is even close to this model. This model is logically consistent, perfectly coherent story, no contradictions in theory. It's a well-defined, self-consistent theory. It has many experimental tests, literally trillions and trillions of them. Everything is consistent with it. Note a single discrepancy between theory and experiment. I'll qualify this statement a little bit later, so don't jump now. Note a single discrepancy between theory and experiment. And it has unprecedented accuracy. Some numbers are easy to calculate. Some numbers are easy to measure. Some numbers are hard to calculate and hard to measure. But some numbers are easy to calculate and easy to measure. And these are the ones that we should focus on, the ones that can be measured very accurately and can be calculated very accurately. And for these numbers, we have 10%, 10 significant digits agreement between theory and experiment. This is really mind-boggling. Every single digit in this sequence of numbers tells us something. The first few test quantum mechanics and special relativity. The others test details of the electromagnetic interactions. As we add more and more digits, this is specifically the magnetic moment of the electron. And as we add more and more digits, they probe more and more details of the theory, both the intellectual structure and the parameters of the theory. And by the time we get agreement for 10 significant digits, we really have a feeling that, yes, we know what we're saying. This is not random that we have such accuracy. There's no other branch of science that comes even close to such accuracies. So this is really exciting. But as I said before, the exciting thing in science is not the things we understand. We shouldn't just sit here and celebrate, gee, we have this wonderful model. We are so smart that we figured it out. Let's go and have some beer and have fun. No, the fun is where we have problems. When we have problems is where we have fun, when there are things that we don't understand. And then these are challenges, and better stated, these are clues to what might come ahead. These are the clues for future progress. So we should really focus not on the successes, we should focus on the problems. No, this is not a way to educate children, at least not in the US, but this is what we should be doing in science, not celebrate past successes, but focus on the problems. So I made the list here of open problems, and the list should better be as long as possible so that we expose every single problem so that we know what to focus on in our research. So there are different classes of questions. First, we have a spectrum of particles. Where did they come from? So there is a gauge group. These are the particles that carry the forces. Why do we have these particles and not others? Why do we have these forces of nature and not others? This is kind of a qualitative question. Another qualitative question is the spectrum of quarks and leptons. They have very bizarre charges, very interesting charges. We have no doubt that it is correct, but where did these numbers come from? It looks like a random list. And not only that, the list repeats three times. It comes under the name of generations. So we have a very bizarre list of quantum numbers, and we have no idea where these quantum numbers came from. So this is the first question. Where did the spectrum of particles come from? And it's very qualitative. The second question is what determines the electroweak scale? I'll have a lot more to say about this later, but this is basically the question of where did the mass of the W boson, the Z boson that were discovered in the 80s, and where did the mass of the Higgs that was discovered recently and was measured recently, where did these numbers come from? What determines these numbers? And as I will emphasize a little bit later in the talk, this is a very, very interesting conceptual question. So the first one is more qualitative. This is more qualitative. And this is more qualitative, is both qualitative and quantitative, but it really points to a deep conceptual question. And then there are more quantitative questions. The theory has many Yukawa couplings, roughly speaking, the masses of fermions. And these are very strange numbers, and I'll have more to say about them later. They span five orders of magnitude. Where did these numbers come from? Most of the parameters in the standard model are these, the masses of fermions, something called mixing angles, CP violation, and so forth. Most of the parameters are here, and we have no idea where these parameters come from. It's like looking at chemistry. There's a spectrum of atoms. Mendeleev created the table. He knew the spectrum.
He arranged them even in a table, and there are various numbers like the masses of these atoms, and there could be a question, why do we have these charges? Why do the atoms have the masses they have, and so forth? And we all know that answering these questions was very useful. This was quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics gave us the answer to why Mendeleev's table, the periodic table, has the structure it has and where all these spectrum of particles came from. So this is a good question to focus on. Continuing with the set of questions in the standard model, there's a whole set of numbers there, a whole set of questions that come under the names of hierarchies. So I've already alluded to the fact that the spectrum of fermions in the standard model are strange, and they span five orders of magnitude, ranging from the electron, which is the lightest, to the top, which is the heaviest. So these are not some numbers, one of them is 2, the other is 7, and another one is 0.3, and so forth. But they span five orders of magnitude with some pattern, and this is something that really begs for an explanation, and we have no idea what the explanation is. Other parameters in the standard model are CKM angles. They are small. We have no idea why they are small. There's another parameter, the strong CP problem. It's called the strong CP problem. The parameter is theta QCD. Experimentally, it could be a number of order 1. Experimentally, it's less than 10 to the minus 11. And this value keeps going down as we do more and more of these precision experiments that I mentioned earlier. So this number is likely to go down further in the coming years, and it will either be a stronger inequality, so theta QCD is smaller, or a number will be measured. But in any event, when we have a number, a dimensionless number, this is actually an angle, so it's naturally between 0 and 2 pi, and when the angle is 10 to the minus 11, or less than that, it really begs for an explanation. Why do we have such a small number? And the other small numbers are the electroweak scale and the Higgs, the electroweak scale and the Higgs mass, and I will discuss them in more detail. So all these are different hierarchies. The next question we have is the question of dark matter. We have no doubt that dark matter exists. We have evidence for dark matter coming from the dynamics of the universe as a whole, the dynamics of galaxies, cluster of galaxies. Wherever we look, we see that there must be some dark matter. We know a lot about it. We have no idea what it is. And this dark matter could be interesting. There are searches for dark matter. The bounds continue to improve. So far, not a single result. So that's something to pay attention to. And then we have neutrino masses. They were measured during the last few decades, gradually. These numbers are actually, strictly speaking, going beyond the standard model. The minimal standard model have zero masses. But that we understand why the masses are not really a problem at our energies. These are problems associated with higher energy physics. And one interesting thing here is that there are some mixing angles here. I mentioned the mixing angles of the quarks before as being small, and I asked, why are these angles so small? Here the numbers are not small. So there's some angles in the mixing angles in the neutrino sector, they are not small. We have no idea why some of them are small, some of them are not small. And again, all these things smells like there's a story behind it, and we don't know what it is. Now, I'd like to give some historical perspective, and I'm sufficiently old to have a historical perspective. And I decided to put the boundary more or less 35 years ago. This is more or less when I started following this field, which tells you how old I am. So I'll give some historical perspective from the late 70s. Every single one of these problems that I just mentioned was known in the late 70s. That's interesting. So about 35 years ago, the list of questions was very similar. And despite a lot of progress during these 35 years, it's fair to say that we still have no clue about any single one of them. That appears to be depressing, or maybe you should view it as an opportunity, depending on your age. I think that the best chance of making progress is to continue the fantastic work at the LHC. The LHC has been working extremely well, and it will continue to work well. I have no doubt about that, and of course the other experiments I mentioned, and hope that some physics beyond the standard model will be discovered, physics that will shed light on at least some of these questions I mentioned. So this is the negative side of the perspective, that here are the problems. We had these problems in the late 70s, and where are we now? Well, more or less where we were 35 years ago. But this is really not fair, because there's been enormous progress in the last 35 years. So in the coming slides, I'll summarize the experimental and the theoretical progress of the last 35 years. And of course, if I'm going to have one slide for all the experimental progress and one slide for all the theoretical progress, I will definitely not do justice to every single thing that was done over these years by thousands of people. But I'll try to do it anyway. So the first thing that happened on the experimental side is that all the parameters of the standard model were measured. 35 years ago, the mass of the W and the Z were not known. So they were measured now, and we know that happened already in the 80s. The masses of all the quarks were measured. 35 years ago, the top was not even discovered. And now we know all the masses with increasing accuracy. All the mixing angles were measured. 35 years ago, we did not know what the values of most of the mixing angles. We knew the Khabibbo angle, but the others were either, we knew they were not zero, but did not know the value, but in the others, we had no idea whatsoever. And most recently, the mass of the Higgs that was discovered only a few years ago. The second front with a lot of progress was neutrino physics. People have been talking about neutrino masses, but now we know what they are. They were measured during the past few decades. And this is clearly going beyond the standard model, and I've already mentioned it before. And of course, there's the whole field of cosmology. We have precision cosmology now. We didn't have it 35 years ago. We have a lot of evidence that dark matter exists. We know how much there is in dark matter. Very surprising is dark energy. This caught us all by surprise when it happened. And of course, inflation was suggested during this time window of 35 years and was explored. And we continue to get more and more confirmation for inflation coming from the spectrum of fluctuations in the microwave background, most recently the exciting development, the exciting announcement of BICEP 2. So this is my one slide summary of the experimental progress, and now I'll have one slide summary of the theoretical progress. It's kind of all of the development in four bullets. So first, cosmology, I've already mentioned a lot of the excitement about the early universe and the theory of inflation. The other developments on the theoretical side during these 35 years are not directly related to experiment, but extremely interesting and extremely surprising and undoubtedly very deep. We got much better understanding of quantum field theory and its dynamics, how to think about it, what are its possible phases, how to think about confinement, et cetera, et cetera. The second thing is better understanding of quantum gravity. This is through string theory. This is something that 35 years ago, graduate students who came to schools like that did not have a single lecture on string theory, and now it's all over the map. And also its surprising properties, showing that this is still a project at the beginning. We're still exploring this theory. And many powerful connections between these ideas and between them and modern mathematics. This is a very rich subject with lots of connections between field theory and mathematics and string theory and mathematics and field theory and string theory and so forth. And this is continuing to be explored. So it's fair to say that during the past 35 years, we've seen enormous progress both on the experimental front and on the theoretical front. And I see no sign of slowing down. I think this will be the next 35 years will be as exciting as the past 35 years. But now I'm going to focus on one of the problems of the standard model, one of the problems I stressed before, and that's the hierarchy problem. So the hierarchy problem is really a problem with dimensional analysis. So if I take this pointer and I throw it up and catch, this is an experiment in gravity, you can ask how high does it go? And you know that there's acceleration in the Earth, g, and the height on dimensional grounds is gt squared. For that, we don't have to do anything. This is just dimensional analysis. And then the actual answer is a half in front of it, but the half in front of it is a number of order one, so we are not surprised. And dimensional analysis usually works in physics. In physics, you do dimensional analysis, kind of back on the envelope calculation, and it gives you more or less the right answer. And when dimensional analysis fails, it really means that there's something fundamental we are not understanding. If we get a small number for no good reason, two numbers are equal for no good reason, when dimensional analysis does not work, it means there's something deep we are not understanding. So in the context of particle physics, as far as I know, the first person to be bothered by that is no other but Dirac. And Dirac was very interested in large numbers. He already knew about the Planck scale, and he knew about the proton mass. And he realized that there are about 19 orders of magnitude between the Planck scale and the proton mass. And he asked himself, where did this hierarchy of 19 orders of magnitude come from? Why is it that if the fundamental scale of nature is the Planck scale, why is it that the proton is so much lighter than the Planck scale? So Dirac was a good physicist, so he asked a good question. And actually today, we know the answer to this question, which shows that one should really focus on these questions, and figuring them out is an interesting thing to do because it teaches us deep things. So the answer to that follows from what is known as asymptotic freedom. And it's given by such a formula that m proton over m Planck is e to the minus a, a number of order one, divided by g squared, a coupling constant. And this is actually the only way physicists know how to produce very small numbers. This is really a prototype and the only one, only mechanism to produce small numbers. How do we do that? If we take g, which is small, but not very small, and we stick it in the exponent like this, with a number of order one, we could easily get numbers which are much smaller than one. So this is really the perfect example of how we get very small numbers in physics through such exponential suppression. And this is the case for the proton mass. And by doing that, there's an answer to Dirac's question. But again, as I said before, in physics, we shouldn't just celebrate the successes, but we should look for the problems. Because in another version of Dirac's question, which we don't know the answer to. Okay, we understand the mass of the proton, but we don't understand the mass of the W, the Z, and the Higgs boson. So these are roughly 100 GeV. The mass of the M Planck is around 10 to the 19 GeV. So instead of having a discrepancy of 19 orders of magnitude, we have progress, but we still have a discrepancy of 17 orders of magnitude. And why is that true? Now, this is very deep. The fact that QCD has such asymptotic freedom and leads to such a formula is a very deep, very interesting, very important result in physics. I believe that the answer to this question will be even deeper than this one. This is still an open question, and for the younger members in the audience, this is a challenge. Please, please figure out the answer to this question. This is basically a question of Dirac. It's been around for about 100 years, and we still don't know the answer. So this is a challenge. More generally, I'll talk about the intuitive hierarchy problem. Where did these small numbers come from? And I've mentioned before some small numbers, like the ratio of the mass of the electron to the mass of the top. This is 10 to the minus 5. I mentioned theta QCD. It's less than 10 to the minus 11, maybe even 10 to the minus 12 or 13 or 14 as the bound keeps improving. And here we have 10 to the minus 17. Dimensional analysis fails, and we ask ourselves, why? Why is it that dimensional analysis fails? And since then, you could see the giants of physics over the 20th century were really baffled by this question and its various aspects. So the first of them is Weisskopf. He said in quantum field theory, we should avoid processes that have quadratic divergences. Logarithmic divergences are okay, but quadratic divergences are bad. This was a very primitive way of saying what I'm going to say now from the eyes of more modern physicists. The second incarnation of this problem is due to another giant of physics. This is Ken Wilson. He said that small-scalar masses are unnatural. Wilson was very interested in the connection between particle physics and condensed matter physics. In fact, many of his ideas were about particle physics, really had their intuition coming from condensed matter physics. And having a light scalar in the language of condensed matter physics is like being very close to a second order phase transition. So it is as if we are in the lab and we have a knob to turn, and we turn the knob to be very close to a phase transition, The relevant number is actually not the ratio of masses, but the square of that. So if we have a ratio of masses, which is 10 to the 17, the square is 10 to the 34. So you have a knob, and you have a transition at some point, and you tune the knob to be within 10 to the minus 34 of the critical point. That's really unnatural. Why did you turn the knob like that? Who is it that arranged all the parameters of nature to be so close to a phase transition, but not at the phase transition? This is with the analogy to condensed matter physics. And in the way Wilson phrased it, scalar masses suffer from large quadratic divergences, and therefore, we have this fine tuning. A more physical way of stating the same problem is as we move in the years, and it's another giant of theoretical physics. This is Steve Weinberg. And Steve Weinberg did not like this way of phrasing it in terms of divergences. That's, of course, very deep. There's no divergence in physics. This whole discussion about divergences is very misleading. Instead, he asked, what happens if we have a theory like the weak interactions or the standard model, and we embed it in a bigger theory? So imagine we have another theory at shorter distances, a theory like grand unified theory or the gravity or what have you. And now imagine we take the parameters at short distance and we tweak them a little bit, say 10%. We change the numbers by 10%. What effect will this have on the parameters of the low energy physics? So we would like physics to be stable, namely small changes of the parameters at high energy induce small changes of the answers at low energies. And the issue with scalars, with particles with zero spin, is that that's not true. The physics at long distance is unstable under small changes of the parameters at short distance. So the long distance physics changes dramatically as we make tiny changes of the parameters at short distance. So this was Weinberg's take on it. And as we continue to go through the 20th century physicist, the next person in the list is at Hooft. And at Hooft said it even more physically. He said numbers shouldn't be zero for no good reason. Number could be very small or zero, only where the point zero is special. And the point zero is special if the theory has more symmetry. So if we have a theory that has some parameter, and the parameter is exactly zero, it should be that exactly zero is a special point, is a point of more symmetry. Because if it's not a point of more symmetry, you might call it zero, and I might call it 7.3. And 7.3 is not a special number. And if we have a number that is very small, but not exactly zero, say 10 to the minus 11, it should better be that the point zero is a point of special symmetry, and we are just close to it. So that would make it more natural, and he refers to it, the whole idea, as naturalness. So we have seen various takes on the same question, and you can see that the greatest minds of 20th century physics really tackled this problem, starting with Dirac and ending with at Hooft. All of them were very concerned about this question of hierarchy and how to understand it. So to summarize it, there are really two distinct aspects of the question. The first aspect of the question is more intuitive. Where did small numbers come from? If we are faced with a small number, we would like to understand intuitively why it is so. Why do we have this small number? And then we can ask ourselves, why doesn't dimensional analysis work? Because this is really the failure of dimensional analysis. Dimensional analysis says that dimensionless numbers would be numbers of order one. We can have pi or maybe pi square. We might even tolerate 5 pi square. But we don't want 10 to the 500. So we want something, numbers not to be too big, not to be too small. If this is the only problem, we could say that, well, maybe we can postpone the question. It's not physics at nearby energies will solve the problem, but one day we'll understand physics at much higher energies, and that will solve this problem. This will explain where these small numbers come from. So this is the intuitive hierarchy problem, or the intuitive naturalness problem, that would like to understand just intuitively where did these numbers come from. There's a technical aspect of the problem that is much deeper and much more interesting. And the point is that if we have some approximation that we see a hierarchy, we would like to make sure that higher order corrections do not destabilize it. Example, imagine you have in quantum mechanics two energy levels that are nearly degenerate. We can actually change the parameters, say the electric field or the magnetic field or the chemical potential or what have you, and move the levels a little bit such that they would be exactly the same. That would look unnatural. Imagine we did that. But what typically happens in quantum mechanics is that this is never the case. You can never get two energy levels to cross. Because if you look at quantum mechanics books, they will tell you that energy levels repel each other. And as you change the parameters, they kind of come in order to cross, but then they rearrange and they never cross. Energy levels are not degenerate unless there is a symmetry that guarantees it. Without a symmetry, this never happens. So this is an example of this tactical naturalness. This is the question that if number is very small, for no good reason, namely no symmetry, there must be, and there's this issue with the approximation. In some approximations, it's the number is small, but higher order corrections destabilize it. Then the explanation for that must be nearby energies. Another way of saying it is that we talked before about things being unstable or unnatural. That's what happens in classical physics. In quantum mechanics, the issue is much more serious. Quantum mechanics has quantum fluctuations. So if something is very sensitive to small changes in the parameters, in quantum mechanics, the parameters fluctuate. And since the parameters fluctuate, the sensitivity to these parameters that fluctuate becomes enormous. So if in classical physics, we can imagine that somebody will one day explain why a certain parameter was tuned to a special value, in quantum mechanics, this cannot happen because everything is going to fluctuate in the end of the day, and this will restore dimensional analysis. Every special thing that somebody tuned is going to be ruined by quantum fluctuations. So this is the technical aspect of the problem, and the idea is that such things have to be solved immediately, or maybe at the next order of magnitude. So if the mass of the W and the Z and the Higgs is around 100 GeV, we would expect this problem to be solved by 1 TeV. Maybe we can postpone the solution till 5 TeV, but it's hard to imagine that it will be postponed much beyond that. So now let's review some of the hierarchy problems I mentioned before and fit them into this classification. So the first is the hierarchy of fermion masses and mixing angles. We said there are many small numbers there. The mass of the electron over the mass of the top is 10 to the minus 5. And there are also all sorts of Kabibbo angles and mixing angles. They're very small numbers. But here we have only the intuitive hierarchy, not the technical one. Because the Hooft would tell us, examine what happens if you take this small number and set it to zero. Is it more symmetric? And the answer is yes. If we take the mass of the electron and make it exactly zero, the theory is more symmetric. And therefore, we do not have the technical problem. We only have the intuitive problem. And as I said before, the explanation of the intuitive problem can be postponed. So it is perfectly reasonable that we have this problem, we have this small number that we do not understand, and the explanation of why the mass of the electron is 5 orders of magnitude below the mass of the top, the explanation of that could be at 10,000 TeV, maybe even higher than that. There is no logical contradiction here. So we can postpone this kind of question. The second hierarchy problem that I wanted to mention is the strong CP problem. This is this parameter that measures CP violation in the strong interaction. Here we have both the intuitive and the technical problem. There is no enhanced symmetry when theta is exactly zero. In terms of divergences, we have logarithmic divergences, but no quadratic divergences. So the explanation must involve low energy physics, and indeed proposed explanations that people suggested involve low energy physics. And the jury is still out of whether these explanations are right or wrong, but we don't lose much sleep over it because we have explanations at hand that have not yet been ruled out. In particular, there is active search for axions. These are particles that should exist in order to solve this problem. So I don't want to spend too much time on this problem. I want to mention the other one, which I've already mentioned before. This is electroweak scale, the mass of the Higgs boson and the mass of the W and the Z. And as I told you, intuitively, there's 17 orders of magnitude, or if you view the square, as is really appropriate, we have tuning of one part in 34, 10 to the 34. Here we have the full problem in our face. We don't understand why it is there. We have both the intuitive problem and the technical problem. And therefore, we think that the explanation should really be around the corner. In fact, many of us are surprised that we have not yet seen the explanation. When I first learned about this problem several decades ago, I was sure that the explanation, for example, supersymmetry, will be discovered very soon, within a few years. And we have been waiting and waiting, and then we thought, okay, the LHC will almost definitely find it. This hasn't happened yet. Maybe it will find it in run two after the upgrade. Maybe not. So this is one reason we really want to focus on this problem. This is one of these problems that the LHC might solve. It's kind of overdue. It could have done it earlier. But we could still live with the solution in the next run. But this has not happened yet. But having said all that, we have the biggest hierarchy of them all. It's the elephant in the room, the big elephant in the room. And this is the cosmological constant. So this was a big surprise. The cosmological constant is also divergent. And here the fine-tuning is one part in 10 to the 120. This is really the worst prediction of dimensional analysis. Dimensional analysis would say that the cosmological constant, or the dark energy, is 1 in Planck units, maybe pi square or 1 over pi square. But in fact, it is 120, 10 to the minus 120 times the natural number in Planck units. And this is the worst prediction in physics. And we have to understand why it is so. So going back to my 35-year time frame, 35 years ago, we thought that the cosmological constant was 0. I remember that very well. And people said, well, we don't understand why it is 0, but one way we will understand that there will be a principle that sets it to 0. Now we know that this is not true. It's not 0. It's 10 to the minus 120. And it's not that one day we'll understand why it's 0, because it's just not 0. Another way of saying it, it's not that we're looking for a qualitative answer of why it's 0, but now there has to be a calculation. It's not just the principle telling, oh, it must be 0, but the principle must be a little bit inaccurate by 10 to the minus 120 to produce this number that we see. All this really shakes our prejudice about naturalness. Maybe this whole idea about naturalness is completely wrong. Maybe all these giants of theoretical physics over the 20th century had the wrong idea about what it is that we should be concerned with. And there's another way of thinking about this whole class of ideas. This would be very strange, because this idea of naturalness is common in physics. It's all over the map. And why should it fail exactly now? So let me tell you, I'll spend a few slides now summarizing where we are with natural solutions of this hierarchy problem. So the first possibility is Technicolor. Well, Technicolor is basically dead. It has been dead for a long time. Precision measurements of the standard model, more specifically what is known as the S&T parameters, and more recently the mass of the Higgs, really prove that Technicolor is not right. And more intuitively, without doing too many calculations, you see, I always like finding an explanation that does not depend on doing a calculation. For one thing, I make mistakes when I make calculations. But when there's a good intuitive, qualitative argument, you know it's right, you feel it's right. And the point is that the mass of the Higgs tells us that the Higgs is weakly coupled. The coupling of the Higgs to itself and the Higgs to all the other particles is small numbers. By now we know what they are. These are small numbers. And if there's strong dynamics around, strong dynamics tends to produce large couplings, because it's strong. So particles couple to each other strongly. So this is really the reason why the mass of the Higgs is too light, or the Higgs coupling is too small to come from Technicolor. Now, there are more sophisticated composite Higgs models. Perhaps they could work, but they're very complicated, very artificial, and I wouldn't put my money there. So I think Technicolor is basically dead. Let's move to supersymmetry. With supersymmetry, it's hard to make it natural. In the MSSM, the minimal supersymmetric model, the Higgs self-coupling is related to the gauge coupling. And we know the gauge coupling, and we know the mass of the Higgs, and that tends to an inequality that the mass of the Higgs has to be less than the mass of the Z. Recall the mass of the Z is around 90, mass of the Higgs is over 100. This inequality is just wrong. Well, if you include radiative corrections, you can improve things a little bit, but it's still very hard to reach 125. In order to reach 125, we really have to go to a corner of the parameter space that a particle called stop, this is the supersymmetric partner of the top, is very heavy. And there's a parameter called A term, it has to be very large, and we might also need to go beyond the minimal model, and we might need to use every one of them. For lack of time, I'm going to skip some details of that, but the bottom line is that every one of these options is perhaps tolerable. Having three of them together, it makes me very uncomfortable. So even with supersymmetry, we have a problem. The Higgs is too heavy for supersymmetry. So again, the Higgs is too light for technicolor and too heavy for supersymmetry. So we are kind of have a problem. So what are our options at this point? First option, naturalness is correct. This whole prejudice we had over decades is really correct. And we will find experimentally either a natural SUSY, somehow supersymmetry will arise in a natural way. Maybe we will find some other solutions which is natural to this hierarchy, something that will explain why the Higgs is so light compared to the Planck scale. And hopefully this whole thing will come soon. I remind you the LHC will start operating again very soon, and it will have data. So this is something that in a few years we will definitely know. So this is option one. Option two, physics in the TEV range is unnatural. This whole idea of naturalness was completely wrong. And this could arise several different ways at the LHC. Option one, the Higgs and nothing else. This is something that could still happen. They measure the properties of the Higgs. It's a standard model, no correction to the standard model. That's all there is there. This could happen. And that would tell us that it's unnatural. There are various other ideas like unnatural split supersymmetry. And it could also be that there are other particles that are discovered at the LHC, but they just do not address the question of naturalness. Well, if we go with this option of unnaturalness, that the universe is not natural, we'll really have to re-examine this whole naturalness idea. And this is not that some stupid people didn't think of the details right. These are very, very deep people with spectacular track record using a lot of evidence that exists out there. So many people believe in it, but we might need to re-examine it. So I arrange it in some kind of a flow chart to arrange our thinking. So when you hear the details of the LHC, what they discover, the first question you ask yourself, is there something beyond the single Higgs? Or is there only a single Higgs? This is the number one question. If the answer is no, then we should abandon naturalness. That's the quickest way to say. If it's a standard model and nothing else, forget about naturalness. If the answer is yes, the next question is electroweak breaking natural? Is there a natural explanation for the scale of the weak interaction, the mass of the Higgs, the mass of the W, and the mass of the Z? And there are two options. If it's no, we abandon naturalness. And if it's yes, the world is natural, and so forth. So this is a flow chart to keep in mind. Once we get the details of the answer, it's sufficiently simple that everybody can memorize it. Once we hear information about the LHC, the first question is it going beyond the standard model? If it is going beyond the standard model, does it say anything about naturalness? And then we end up with one of these boxes. Either we abandon naturalness or the world is natural. What is it to say if it's not natural? So the leading option in this possibility is that we have a landscape of vacua, many, many vacua, many people like that, and we even use the A word that I don't want to mention here. And the idea is that the universe is much bigger than we think. We have a multiverse with lots and lots of universes, with the values of the parameters different in different universes, and even the spectrum of particles could be different in the different universes, and maybe even the number of dimensions of space and time could be different in the different universes. All options are on the table, and we have such a multiverse, and The laws of physics are different in different places. And the values of these parameters in this universe is what it is for some reasons that are not very deep. Just we happen to live here in some other universe has some other values, and there might or might not be people in the other universe. We don't know what exists there, but this is just random. So all these numbers we don't understand, these are not numbers that we should predict. These are just environmental parameters. And it's good to give a historical precedent of that. So Kepler was very interested in the orbits of the planet. This is a fantastic history. You can get so many lessons from this part of history. So Kepler knew about six planets, and he did spectacular work understanding their orbits, work that eventually led to Newton's laws of mechanics. So this was clearly good. He managed to take a lot of data and summarize it using very small number of parameters. So instead of having epicycles for the motion of the planets, instead of measuring where every planet is at every time and find these complicated trajectories, he packaged it all in terms of a small number of ellipses. This is clearly progress. Put the sun in the center, not the Earth. This is also very conceptual, interesting, almost theological progress. And then he wanted to explain the sizes of the orbits. So what did he do? He said, well, we have six planets, and here is a beautiful theory that explains them. We know five platonic solids. So we can inscribe them one inside the other, and such that the orbits of the planets are on spheres, which are inscribed either inside or outside different platonic solids. This looks a beautiful theory, ties together really deep mathematics, the fact that there are five platonic solids, something that goes back to the Greek, hence the name platonic solids. And it's tied to something celestial. So what can be better than that, except that it's completely wrong. It's completely wrong because the orbits are ellipses rather than spheres. The numbers also don't work very well. And the real kicker is that there are more than six planets and there are only five platonic solids. So this theory is completely, completely wrong. And the fact that it has beautiful math, deep math in it, does not mean that it's necessarily right. And the answer is that it turns out to be the wrong question. The orbits of the planets, these radii, are what they are because this is what happens to be here. It was created at random through some process in the early universe. And in other solar systems, the radii of the planets are different. And we shouldn't bother by the fact that we don't have a fundamental law of nature predicting the sizes of the planets. Instead, we have some things, some laws of nature, which tell us that they should be on ellipses. So the fact that they are ellipses, this is significant. The actual numbers of the axis of the ellipses, these are not significant. So we have to be careful what questions we ask. And if physics is unnatural, if TV physics is unnatural, there's a question of what should we do? Should we attempt to solve other naturalness problems, like the other ratios that I talked about? Like the ratios of fermion masses, strong CP, mixing angles, and so forth. What are the right questions to ask if this is the setup we are in? If we are in such a situation that all the numbers are environmental, they are not deep, what are the right questions? How do we explore them? Should we just raise our hand and say, well, whatever we don't understand is environmental? Why is the mass of the electron what it is? Well, that's environmental. That's a quick answer to every question, and is not going to lead to further progress. Some might even say that looking for deep, if we follow this logic too far, some might say, well, we shouldn't be looking for deeper truth at shorter distances, because there's no deeper truth at shorter distances. Everything is environmental. Well, the last centuries of physics were following an idea called reductionism. And reductionism is the idea that whatever we see at some length scale follows from deeper truth at shorter distances. This is what led to quantum mechanics. This is what led to nuclear physics and particle physics and so forth. So this has been a fantastic period of centuries of going further and further down to shorter and shorter distances, and we should ask ourselves, is this the end of reductionism? Well, I'm very uncomfortable about accepting this answer. It would kind of be very boring, and it would be much more exciting if there is new physics that revives the idea of, not revives because it's not dead, but there's new physics that invigorates the idea of a naturalness. So in conclusion, what can the LHC find? So now wake up if you fell asleep. This is one-line summary. What can the LHC find? Option one, no discrepancy with the standard model. It will measure more and more with higher and higher accuracy. No discrepancy between the minimal standard model. This is a logical possibility. Then there could be new physics beyond the standard model that does not address the stability of the weak scale. For example, there could be another heavy fermion. It would be very interesting, but it will not address the question of naturalness. Next in this sequence, there could be a natural explanation of the weak scale. I think this will be very exciting. It could be either supersymmetry. Maybe there was something wrong in the reasoning against it. Maybe strong dynamics. Here I'll be even more surprised if there's something wrong in the reasoning against it. And perhaps something else that we haven't yet thought about. As I said before, this is where I put my money. Something we have not yet thought about. Now, all of these options are very interesting. It's not that one of them is less interesting than the other. First of all, they give us correct answers, and as physicists, we should love correct answers. It's not if this and if that and if and if ands and buts, but we know this is what happens, this is right, and we can take it from here. So these give us correct and reliable information about nature, and they point to a deep physical principle with far-reaching philosophical consequences about the universe. Just as the fact that the Earth is not the center of the universe, but the sun is. And then the sun is not the center of the universe, but our galaxy is. And now we have this big universe with all these galaxies, and we are not special at all. We are just tiny creatures on a tiny planet moving around a tiny star. We are also not special in the sense of our universe. Maybe this whole multiverse is right. This is extremely interesting to know. And then we should ask, are we in a special place? Is this the end of reductionism? Again, something that has been working extremely well over the last few centuries. So no matter what happens, I think we are in a win-win situation. Whatever the outcome is, we'll learn something. We'll learn what is true and what is not true. We'll know whether naturalness is right or wrong. We'll know whether our universe is special or not. So it's guaranteed to be exciting. It's guaranteed to be interesting. So I think the future is very exciting, and I think this would be a good slide to end the talk with. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nati. Thank you very much. It was one of the best explanations I've seen of naturalness, and I have seen many, so it's great. Thank you very much. And questions?
Everything was clear.
Yes.
So you say that we have to wait to the LHC results to see if the world is natural or it is not. But even let's suppose that there is SUSY, there is supersymmetry, and then the world according to that is natural. Still we have the elephant problem, the cosmological constant. So why do you think we have to wait to see if there is SUSY or not, if the SUSY problem is already there?
Well, it's a very interesting question, and somebody could say, why am I bothering you with all this naturalness, given that we have this big elephant in the room? Well, you could say that the cosmological constant has something to do with gravity, and here we have a problem within quantum field theory, and with quantum field theory, we really know what we are doing. With gravity, there could be another principle. I don't know, I'm very disturbed, and I had this line there that our ideas about naturalness have already been shaken by the big elephant in the room. But I think that if supersymmetry or another natural explanation of the hierarchy problem is found at the LHC, of course we'll not have to ask this question, your question. We'll know the explanation in the TV range is natural, and of course we'll explore it, and it will be very exciting. We'll learn what it is, we'll explore the parameters and so forth, and sooner or later we'll have to face the deeper question of the cosmological constant. And who knows what will be there? It could also be that the cosmological constant is not natural and it's set environmentally, whereas the parameters of the standard model, or at least some of them, do have a natural explanation at nearby energies. I think that raising our hands and say, well, everything is environmental, we don't know where it comes from, we'll never know, and we shouldn't explore it, that's clearly misguided. We should really be focusing on what can be measured and measure whatever can be measured. And hopefully, things will fit together in this framework.
I want to say that LHC, its attribute parameters, for instance, they give us Higgs mass before even Higgs observation. Higgs mass 90 GeV and 126 GeV is one sigma far from this 90 GeV. So within one sigma, okay, more than one sigma, there is not any hints that there is a new physics seen at LHC. So there is no, probably there will be no any new particles, no supersymmetry.
I didn't understand what you were saying.
My saying is following, that LHC, there is no hints, there is no any trace for supersymmetry. Because, for instance, Higgs mass, if you go to oblique parameters, so radiation correction to W mass, Z boson mass, sinus squared, Weinberg angle, so there is no, so this gives us that 90 GeV for Higgs mass. And 126 GeV is one sigma far from this 90 GeV.
Yeah, but the theoretical you see, you use sigmas when you have statistical distribution. Sigma is a number from statistics. You say, well, you're one sigma away, that's good enough. But the discrepancy here is not statistical. These are very firm predictions. In other words, it is as if you increase the number of measurements by a lot, and you know with very high accuracy all the numbers. We are not willing to tolerate even five sigma, less statistically significant discrepancies, because these are two clear theoretical predictions. There is a real discrepancy between our understanding of naturalness and the measurements at the LHC. Now, there is no discrepancy with the standard model. With the standard model, there is no problem whatsoever. The LHC measurement fits the standard model. The problem is it does not fit embedding the standard model in supersymmetry. The only way it could show that there is supersymmetry is if some superpartners are discovered, or at least we see a discrepancy from the standard model. As long as there is no discrepancy with the standard model, there's really no reason to add anything to it.
Okay, I have two provocative questions, if you don't mind. So, one is when you said this could be the end of reductionism, but we know that, for instance, this multiverse story is not just coming out of the blue, but it's just one of the solutions of string theory give you the multiverse. So, and this comes from a fundamental theory. They could approach not only the hierarchy problem, but also the cosmological constant problem. So, could that be a way to recover reductionism in a different way, because the reductionism will be going to the deeper principle, which is the fundamental theory, and that will give you that as an outcome.
Okay, I'd like to answer that. Of course, it's true, and it's one of the arguments in favor of such a multiverse, that string theory naturally leads to such a multiverse. And inflation also leads to... So, another way of saying it, that string theory naturally leads to a multiverse, lots and lots of vacuum solutions, and inflation gives us a mechanism to populate all of them. So if we indeed have this chaotic inflation, it could populate all these different vacua of string theory and have a multiverse with lots of universes with different parameters. And then the question is, what's next? So one scenario is that somebody very smart who does string phenomenology, maybe you, can say, look, there are 10 to the 500 different vacua, but all of them have something in common. Some number is the same in all of them, because it's pi square or something. And if we see that in the standard model, this parameter is indeed pi square, then we say this number is really fundamental, and it reflects short distance physics, and everything else is completely random. Example, the orbits of the planets, the fact that they are ellipses, that's fundamental. If we see that one planet is not on a perfect ellipse, this could be the sign that we forgot to include more force, for example, in another planet. And in fact, some of the planets were discovered this way. Some of the planets were discovered by showing that other planets do not move on perfect ellipses. So that's deep. That's a sequence. This is a consequence of Newton's equations, and that's deep. With the actual radii of the orbits, this is less deep. So this is one way it could happen, that some numbers are deep and some numbers are not. Also, another way it could happen is that, again, from the example of the orbits, there are orbits that are more stable than others. If you look at the numbers, I'm not an expert in that, but I know that some numbers, some orbits are more stable, and therefore, if we start from an orbit which is not one of these stable ones, it will tend to drift into the more stable ones. So we are more likely to find things that are on one kind, but not of the other. Some of these environmental parameters, we are more likely to find one value than another. If somebody could say that within string theory, within this whole multiverse, we have similar preference, some natural stability principle that attracts us to some vacua, but not others, and then we live in that one, that would be also progress. But the attitude in most of this multiverse study is that it doesn't matter what's more likely. We have the numbers we have because that's where we happen to live, and we cannot explore the other ones. That's all, for me, it sounds almost like raising our hands and say, declare defeat. We'll never explain anything. So what should we explore? Is everything environmental or not? So I try to give a provocative answer, if I may.
Very good. That's perfect. No, I think we would say the natural thing would be some questions are good questions and some questions are not very good questions. And the not good questions are the ones that are environmental, and but then we may remain the other good questions and the questions to identify which are these good questions.
So which are the deep and which are not?
I think the deep ones are the ones that we can answer. The non-deep ones are the environmental, as you say, with the
yeah,
example.
Yeah, but we don't
know
a priori which is in which category.
Exactly.
Is the mass of the bottom divided by the mass of the strange quark? Is this ratio environmental or not? I don't know.
Exactly. That's the challenge. Very good. Very good. Okay. Oh, there's another question. Daniel.
Just an idea. Finally, the big important things are changes of paradigm. Now, in the 20th century, we have seen two essential. One is the dynamics of space-time, isn't it? General relativity. And the other one is quantum mechanics. But really speaking, these two paradigms are not really consistent. So we need still a new change of paradigm. Fortunately, I would say, we have that still we do not have a theory which is consistently quantum, and a quantum consistent theory of space-time. Perhaps that is the thing that we are missing too. That perhaps will change even the way in which we ask the questions.
I sympathize.
So it is a fortunate thing that we have this hole.
I sympathize with it completely. I'll just rephrase it slightly, if you may, Daniele, and that's, we have a consistent theory, but I don't think we fully understand it. So we have a theory, and you were one of the main people who contributed to it, string theory, and we don't understand it to the end. And it might be that some of these questions are tied to deep issues about how space-time emerges in string theory. So maybe, here is a speculation, I just thought of it during the colloquium, of course, that one day we'll understand how space-time emerges. This will give us a more detailed picture of the Big Bang and inflation, and that will really select the correct vacuum out of string theory. So this could still happen, and it goes along the lines that you said. We have to understand how space-time emerges and its physics at the early universe, and it really shows the unity of ideas in physics, that quantum gravity and string theory on one side, particle physics on traditional particle physics with the LHC and so forth on the other side, and cosmology on the third side. And this is perhaps one of the reasons this BICEP 2 announcement is so exciting, because maybe it gives us clue to quantum gravity, which can lead to better understanding of how space-time emerges, and perhaps will also get rid of this conundrum that we have here. Having said that, I think on the faster time scale, we'll get input from the LHC, which will clearly be extremely helpful in addressing this question.
Well, I can ask my second provocative question. You said that at the end of LHC, we will know one way or another naturalness or not naturalness. But then there's this proposal for 100 TV machine either at CERN or in China. We know that NIMA has left, but what is your take about that?
I think it's a wonderful thing to build. I encourage both the Europeans and the Chinese to do it. And I wish the Americans also built a machine like that. And not just because of supersymmetry. I think the argument to build it is much more elementary. We should build it because we can. We should explore whatever we can explore. And nobody tells us, you know, theorists can sit all day and talk natural, not natural, fine-tune, not fine-tune. The experimentalists should just ignore it. They can build a better machine, they should build a better machine. And let them measure what they can measure. And then we theorists will come and try and figure out what it all means. This is how physics evolved over the years. You measure what you can. So if you can build a 100 TeV machine, please do, please. And if there's anything I can do to help.
Great, we count on you, very good. Okay, so this is not over. So now I will ask everybody, essentially everybody except for our diploma students, to leave the room. And our diploma students will come here. For the people who are leaving the room, you will get some refreshments. And so, but before you do that, let's thank Lati again.